Well, good afternoon. Good to have you joining me again. Looking forward to our Bible study together as we continue, really commence the study on the Man of Sorrows. And there's probably no title the Lord Jesus has that so speaks to our hearts, particularly in times of need, is this wonderful title, A Man of Sorrows. So let's begin with a word of prayer, and then we'll look in at that a bit tonight. Father, thanking you again for your goodness to us. Lord, we thank you for the reminder to us of the Lord that you didn't take the easy road. You didn't come without a purpose. But Lord, you carried the title, A Man of Sorrows. And how we want that to speak into our hearts. Lord, may it draw us near to yourself. May it cause us to be quick to cry out to you. Lord, may it humble us to recognize and realize afresh what you've done for us. So, Lord, in all of these things, we'd ask that you'd meet with us and teach us by your Spirit. You'd encourage our church family and many others who are in great need in this time. And we just thank you for it and ask again that we'd be good students, Lord, ready to hear what the Spirit has to say. In your name we pray it. Amen. Amen. Well, we had a message last week entitled, Who Cares? Who Cares? And with the disciples who were in the ship when the storm came up, and you remember they woke them and said, Master, don't you care that we're perishing? Well, not quite the question to ask the Lord Jesus, is it? If there's anyone who cares about men and women perishing, it's the Lord Jesus. He came to seek and save those who are lost. He came to rescue the perishing, as we want love to sing about it. And indeed, he came to rescue the likes of you and I. So we know he cares, and we want tonight to look at the fact that his own choice in the scriptures, that is, by the Spirit, of calling himself a man of sorrows. How much does he care? He cares enough to be identified with us. As a matter of fact, we want to look at two parts of the study. We want to look at the fact that he was a man, and secondly, that he was a man of sorrows. In the phrase, a man, we'll look at tonight, he identifies with us. In the phrase, sorrows, or man of sorrows, he sympathizes with us. But he's not just one who sympathizes, he's one who sympathizes or empathizes. But he also brings hope and reality, healing to the hurting. It's not just that we have a friend, but we have a friend who's well able to help us. And that's the difference in the Lord Jesus. Take your Bibles tonight as we begin our study and go back to Isaiah 53. Isaiah chapter 53. I hardly have to mention the text, and you know where I'm going, most of you. There's much to be said here, but in this little segment, I'm going to look with you at verses 3 through 5, and then come back to look at verse 3. But in our study, we'll keep these verses in focus. Isaiah 53. And of course, this psalm is a psalm that's written, speaks about the Lord Jesus dying for the sins of men, being our sin bearer. And here we have it very clearly in verse 3. He is despised and rejected of men. A man of sorrows, acquainted with grief, and we hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised, and we esteemed him not. Surely he hath borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was buried for our iniquities. The price of the chastisement of our peace, the punishment of it, the chastisement of our peace was upon him. And with his stripes, we are healed. That little phrase at the end gives us a hint to where we'll be going in this study. By his stripes, we are healed. By his sorrows, we can sing, or we have salvation. There's always a consequence, in a good way for us, in the negatives that Christ experiences that we read about in this chapter. We won't conclude with these verses, but they certainly give us a place to begin from. But look again with me, if you would. He is despised and rejected by men. He became a man, but is rejected by men. Struggle to understand that. Even today, he became a man to save men. And yet men today have nothing to do with Christ oftentimes. We must remember that he came to earth to be identified with us, with our failed situation, with our condemnation. He came to enter into that we might be free, that we might be justified, as we've looked in our studies lately. But the title, Man of Sorrows, there may be no greater title to speak of the life of Christ than that of a man of sorrows. From his beginning as a man to his death, a man of sorrows, acquainted with grief, bearing our punishment, wounded for my sins and for your sins. He was a man of sorrows. Why doesn't it say he was a God of sorrows? Why doesn't it say he was a God of sorrows? What ought to rivet our attention to this phrase, man of sorrows? Well, we must understand again, afresh, that he was indeed a man. By the way, this title, Man of Sorrows, is certainly gets the attention of our hearts, our emotions, our feelings, and nothing wrong with that. That's indeed who he was, and he experienced all those things that we might identify with him in our struggles, in our difficulties. And here we have in this study a phrase that in the New Testament, I think of the equivalent, if I can put it that way, that Jesus used for himself when he called himself the Son of Man. Condescension. How could Christ come down and boldly lay claim to that most favorite title of himself, the Son of Man? The Son of Man. Why wouldn't he say, I'm the Son of God, I've come to save you? Because again, when he says the Son of Man, we can identify with him as being, yes, our Savior, but also the Son of God. And that's a powerful phrase as well. Well, back to our study, we want to look at the fact that he is indeed identified with us. And he wants to be. He wants to be. He uses terms like friend, my father's house. I call you my friends, you're my sons, daughters, who's my family? The Lord Jesus thought of us in very familiar terms, very wholesome terms. And he didn't mind associating himself with even what the critics called him, the friend of sinners, with sinners like you and I. As a matter of fact, he came to give his life for us. And indeed, that ought to be a reminder to us of how much Christ wants to be in relationship with us. So look at this here. He was as much a man as we are. He was as much a human as you and I are. He was conceived in the womb, grew in the womb, birthed as any baby is birthed, developed as a young man. As the years passed, he grew into a mature manhood, and he struggled with all the experiences of life, other than sinning, that is, and the consequences of that. But he experienced all the natural parts of humanity that we do experience. You say, yeah, but he didn't sin. How can he know how I live? We're going to get to that in a bit. But the reality is, he lived like you and I lived. It tells us in the scripture, he knew what it was to hunger and to thirst. He knew what it was to hurt. He knew what it was to bleed. He knew what it was to rejoice. He knew what it was to be hurt by way of his feelings being diminished. He knows what it's like to be misunderstood by people, to be rejected by them, to be betrayed by those who are closest to him. And he had emotions that went with that, just like you and I have. When you cut the Lord Jesus, he bled red like the rest of us. He became 100% man, human. No way different, other than the fact that his sin, he was without sin. He had no sin nature. But outwardly speaking, he looked like any other man, because he was, in very, very earnest sense, another man. Another man walking the earth. Another man talking with people. He knew how to make small talk. He knew how to make spiritual talk. Yeah, he had it all, and he displayed it beautifully. He knew what it was to cry. He knew what it was to laugh. Although we don't find that recorded very often, we can be assured of one thing. To be around Jesus, he wasn't a killjoy. He found as much joy in living as anyone. As Phyllis said coming into church a couple of weeks ago, I sometimes don't remember what day it is, but every day is fun day. Well, for the Lord Jesus, he never had a bad day. He had never had a day he didn't give thanks for, appreciate. And certainly he gives us a wonderful example of what it is to live this life and to live it well. To live it before men. It doesn't mean you'll be understood. Doesn't mean you'll be appreciated. But the Father himself is to be pleased. And that was always the goal of the Son of God. And we know, obviously, we come to this study, the Lord Jesus knew what it was to be in anguish, to be in grief, and to be in sorrow. A few minutes ago, I was on the phone with the undertaker locally here, and how difficult it is for them to handle the tragedies of lightning that we had the last weekend. And they don't take that easily. It isn't an easy job. And it sometimes surprises me when an undertaker has a difficult time. I know they're feeling stressed and overwhelmed with the weight of what's coming in their door or over their phone. And that's what the Lord Jesus does with us. He identifies with it. He feels the weight that we bear. And we understand that. We understand who he is. We'll understand how he can help us. And how already he's entered into those things in our lives. Been very instructive to my own heart. Man of Sorrows. Go with me to Philippians, if you would. The book of Philippians, chapter 2. Philippians, chapter 2. We know this wonderful passage talking about the condensation of Christ, how he left heaven and became a man, became a slave in a sense, as he puts it here. It says in verse 7 concerning Christ coming down and becoming a man, but he made himself of no reputation. In other words, he could have claimed to be God and never stooped from that. He could have demanded to be treated like God and given great respect. He didn't do that. He made himself of no reputation, and he took on himself the form of a servant. And he was made in the likeness of men. He was made in the likeness of men. Interesting, isn't it? That God shaped his son in the likeness of man. Again, as a man, you're just a commoner. No one quite understood, it seemed, in Christ's own community, who he was. They didn't understand the words he spoke, because he came in the likeness of man. When he proclaimed to be the Messiah, they said, how could this be? Isn't this the carpenter's son? He's just a man like we are. He lives down the road. We know his parents. We know the family. We know what they say about them. They're certainly not perfect people. They've even heard things about how the conception came about, and they never forgot about that, they thought. And so we find a lot of things in him that make him very human to the world around him. And the advantage of that is only given to us in Scripture. We could point to any man. There are men who stand up and claim to be gods of sorts, saviors of sorts. And they're no different than the people that they claim to be leading. But the difference here is this man was 100% man. But he was 100% God. He was like us in many ways outwardly. But to look at the core of the man, he was unlike any man that ever had walked or has walked upon earth. He was the perfect man. He was the sinless, spotless Son of God. We're coming out about, we're looking at that a lot in our study lately. Friend, that is the power of the gospel. That's the power of the study, the man of sorrows. Unless we understand in our minds and we're reminded of it again and again and again, we stand in danger of doing what many have done in our day, even in preaching, even in teaching, in books that are written, songs that are sung. They go to great lengths to make Christ so human that he hardly looks like a God at all. Friends, our teaching, our thinking ought to be filled with the fact that he was none less than the very God of very gods. And yet, he stooped to become a man. It would be like Psalm 34, where the psalmist says, "Who are we? What is man that you visit him?" It ought to always astonish us that Christ would stoop to become like us. Why? Because he's so holy. He's so righteous. He's so mighty. He's so far up from us, higher than us. And yet he came down like the two on Emmaus Road, and he walked along the road with them and spoke with them. And so those truths ought to be very near and dear to our hearts, even as we enter into this study. He was made in the likeness of men. Why? Why? Because he needed to become one of us in order to save us. This was by God's divine design that Christ became a man. And no other has done this. I just read recently again on a Christian website, another guy claims to have had a near-death experience, and Jesus talked to him, and he's got a message for the world. Buy the book, and you'll get the message. Well, it's just another shenanigan. Jesus said in John 3, just before John 3:16, John 3:13, he said, "No man has ascended up to heaven, and no man, but he that came down from heaven, even the Son of Man who is in heaven," or who is from heaven. No man has gone to heaven and come back other than Jesus Christ. And that's what he claims. And friends, we can stand upon that even to this very day. Well, I mentioned that this was by God's divine design, decree, plan, purpose, and this is what we see. Why did Christ need to become a man? Think with me for a minute. Why didn't God just open up the heavens and shout out the message of salvation? Hey, if you want to be saved, this is the way. You want to get into my ark? It's over here. You come and get in, you'll be safe. We know the ark is a picture of salvation, so I use that one. But why didn't God do that when Joseph and Mary were young people? Why did he choose Mary to conceive by the Holy Spirit and bear a child? Then I thought, if Christ need come as a man, why didn't he just whip up a man, if I can put it that way? He made Adam from the dirt. Why didn't he just make Jesus in his manhood and declare himself to be the Savior of the world? And why didn't he just do that? Follow me to heaven. If you want to go, I'm here. And he could have come even then as a mighty, mighty conquering king. The Jews might have been pleased to recognize that. Probably not. Why didn't God send angels then? Why don't we have, everybody talks about angels today, the spirituality that's going around. Why didn't God commission angels to appear to people suddenly, like he spoke to Mary and Joseph, Gabriel, and speak to them the gospel? I mean, couldn't they do a good job of announcing the gospel to the people in our community? They could have. But none of those things, the announcement from heaven by God, the announcing by angels, the proclaiming of the message by angels, we say God could have done them, but he couldn't have used those things. Because they never could have accomplished what the man of sorrows accomplished for us. Christ becoming a man was necessary. It was essential to the plan of salvation. It was essential to God's plan of salvation. Let's go to Hebrews chapter 10. Wonderful chapter. Probably my favorite chapter in the book for sure. I often quote from it. In verses 1 through 3, the writer of Hebrews shows the inferiority, if I can put it that way, the instability, the temporariness of the Old Testament sacrificial system, a system whereby the animals were sacrificed day upon day, and particularly for the Jews, year by year, the high priest bringing in a blood sacrifice to find forgiveness for the nation. And it says here in verse 1, verse 2, verse 3, the blood of the bulls and goats that were offered again and again and again, really endlessly, day by day, day after day, the shedding of blood, yet none of that blood being spilt or shed could atone for the sins of men once for all. And so it talks about that. Verse 4 here with me, if you would. It is not possible that the blood of bulls and goats should take away sins. It was impossible to have your sins taken away, removed forever, no matter how many lambs were killed, no matter how many prayers were repeated. The blood of animals could never give people eternal forgiveness and eternal life. Now that Christ had come, the Lord no longer took pleasure, as he says here twice, in the Old Testament Levitical system. It was marked with inferiority all over it. And now that Christ had come, it was obsolete. It had no purpose. The purpose of the Old Testament sacrifices was to be a foreshadowing, pointing men and women to Jesus Christ, the true Lamb of God, who would die to take away the sins of men. And that's what we see here. Look at the end of verse 1. I'm going to pick up with the words, can never, the Old Testament sacrifices, can never with those sacrifices which they offered year by year continually make the comers thereunto perfect. They couldn't do it. And then we find again at the end of verse 4, the blood of bulls, it is not possible that the blood of bulls and goats should take away sins. They continued. They were there. Before God, God still saw them. He would cover their sins for a year in the Day of Atonement. But a year afterwards, they had to again apply for another license, spiritually speaking. They had to again seek God's atoning mercy for their sins, year after year after year. But with the coming of Christ, that was to never be the case. Look at verse 12. But this man, Jesus, who? This man, after he had offered one sacrifice for sins as the high priest now, he sat down forever at the right hand of God. His priestly work was accomplished, not every year, but one time, one cross, one sacrifice of himself. Look at with me in our study tonight at verse 5. With this in mind, the Lord says, when he comes into the world, he says, sacrifice and offering thou wouldest not. And the next verses, you find it means God doesn't want them anymore. He's not looking to take pleasure in those anymore. Why? Because his son was coming as a man to become the one sacrifice. John said it well in 129 of the Gospel, John. Behold, the Lamb of God, who what? It comes right out of this chapter, really. Who takes away the sin of the world. He takes it away. They'd never known one lamb who could take away anyone's sin. Their sin wasn't taken away. The Old Testament word, theological word, to atone, simply means a covering, kefer, to cover. The blood of those animals covered their sins for a year, but never by those sacrifices were they taken away. And now the contrast with Christ coming. He came into the world, and it's a sacrifice and offering. The Lord no longer willed it, wanted it. But a body thou hast prepared me. Jesus is saying, if I could put it in our vernacular, but he's made me a physical lamb. He's made me that tangible man who's going to become the Lamb of God for you, for the sins of the world. That word, he made me a body. I often speak of it to show sanctity of the life in the womb. And that's not out of its context at all, because Christ did become a man. And in his manhood, he was made to identify not only with man in our living, but more so. Here's the point of it all. He's made as a man because only as a man could he enter into the prison house of sin where we sit, where we sat, and then break open the bars of the prison and lead the prisoners home to glory, bringing many sons to glory in chapter 2. That's what he does. That's why God couldn't just speak it from heaven and have it be so. We'll come back to this. That's why he couldn't send an angel to proclaim it and tell people how to get saved, because there would be no way to be saved. That's the dilemma here. If Jesus Christ was to save the world of sinners, then there was absolutely, we can be assured of that, no other way other than sending another man. Romans 5. By Adam's disobedience, all became sinners. By Christ, the last Adam, by this man's obedience, many become righteous unto life. Sin unto death, righteous unto life. Unless Christ was willing to leave the glories of heaven and enter into the gates of hell, if I can put it that way. Ephesians 4 might suggest that, but what I mean by that is into death, the greatest enemy man faces. Christ didn't stand outside the grave and curse it. No, he entered into death, and in that place, he gained a victory for every man, woman, and child who put their faith in him. We'll come back to this next week, but we want to continue our study and now identify the fact that when we see the term, or think of the term Christ being a man, that we also think of the fact that he's the man who came to save us. Father, thank you for our time tonight. Thank you for the truth you give us. Lord, help us relish these things and recognize again the great, great, wonderful grace that we have in knowing the grace of God and the Man of Sorrows. I'm going to close tonight with a song from the Gaither group. And the Man of Sorrows, you know it well, maybe, but I'm going to try to get it before you so you can see it and appreciate it. Just meditate on the Lord a little bit.